From AIT Studios in Abuja, Nigeria, this is the O&M Late Show with Obiora Ilo and Mamode Akuga.
Hello there. It's another beautiful Tuesday evening, and this is your O&M Late Show. I am Obiora Ilo. Well, today in the United States, I saw the power of democracy. Here was a visiting president or prime minister who didn't quite have the friendship and love of the president, but you discover the president couldn't stop him from addressing the United States Congress. Mamode.
Well, let me formally welcome numerous viewers to today's show. And of course, today, the power of democracy, Obiora was talking about, and of course, the tolerance of the United States government towards varied views, as it were.
Even if it was coming from outside?
Yes, even if it was coming from, I mean, that's the beauty of democratic government, because no matter what, the way you look at it, not everybody in the United States will have the same opinion as the president of the United States. So they have to accommodate whichever way.
And coming home, the fuel scarcity has continued. We hear the parties trading blames. PDP says APC is the reason. APC says PDP should hide its head in shame. Counter accusations everywhere.
But what is a little bit worrisome to me is the reason coming from Nigeria's Minister of Finance and Coordinating Minister of the Economy, Dr. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala. She is saying that, of course, the situation is due to a mix of factors, including disruption of pipelines and logistical issues.
And what
are we still using this old pipeline thing as excuse for fuel scarcity? Come on, that's too old now. I think we should.
Nobody's owning up to the real reason why this is happening. For many Nigerians that are worried about the long queues, APC and PDP should go and sit down somewhere and just make this fuel available. That's what we want. Not whether it's APC or whether it's PDP.
Oh, somebody and sabotages somebody.
Or somebody sabotages somebody.
I mean, we are just tired
of all these back and forth accusations.
Let the filling stations just have this product. After all, we have the raw materials for it. Mm-hmm. Well, we'll get to talk about the issue of refineries another day. There's still a lot of, you know, ding-dong, back and forth, accusations, left, right, center, about who paid how much, how many billion, how much money for Chatham House facility. APC is accusing PDP and the government, really, of paying some amount of money to Chatham House, the United Kingdom, to enable them allow the National Security Advisor, Colonel Sambo Dasuki, to be able to use that platform to call for the postponement of the general election. Well, this is coming after PDP accused APC of paying millions and millions
but
of naira.
Mamode, it goes back to what I just said. Nigerians are not interested on all these non-issues, but Nigerians are concerned about is their power. Nigerians are concerned, is there civil rights in Nigeria? Nigerians are concerned.
Do we have jobs?
Jobs, do we have jobs? If you go to Yaradua Center to have a function, you will pay. If you go to the National Conference Center to have a function, you will pay. So what is this business about? This one paid or that one didn't pay? Are you not bothered, Mamode, about the pedestrian language that this election has been reduced to?
I think that the candidates who have reduced to just attacking each other and trying to paint the other person as not being good enough.
And
I
a lot of them are going to make billions.
Yes, instead of leaving.
I heard that one of them sued for 50 billion.
Yeah.
The other one countersued for 20 billion.
Well, we will need to have a program to look at all that, but let us look at least a group of persons who are getting some attention as we get close to elections. 43% of Nigeria's population, yes, the youths, the most marginalized in our society, the most unemployed in a society and the most resentful when it comes to castigating recycled leadership. Well, they seem to be getting attention because the other day, President Jonathan met with 5,000 youths in Lagos. The vice presidential candidate of the APC, Professor Shibajo, is meeting youths in Enugu, Lagos, Akwa Ibom. All of a sudden, the youths have become very, very important in this election.
And that's why tonight,
yes,
we are going to look at what are the youths actually looking for or asking the next president to do for them.
Yes.
What values are important to them? What are their concerns? Should they be part of all this violence? What are their views as it concerns governance? Yes. That is the issue we are discussing tonight, and we have an array of very important youths. We have in our studio the President, National Youth Council of Nigeria. I'm sure our cameras will see them now. He's Wale Ajani. Wale Ajani is joining us in a moment. We also have Orire Alao. Orire Alao is also joining us to talk about what are the youths looking forward to in the next government.
Yes.
And what kind of leader would they want? And of course, the big one.
Yes, joining us, the African rep, Marvin Yobana, a man who is synonymous with youth matters in Nigeria. I think he's going to be telling us principally what he thinks that this the current administration has been able to achieve for youths in the last 4 years.
And of course, one of the Nollywood greats, I hope he will look up, Ken Okonkwo, if you remember, but you didn't explain this thing to me properly. That's living in bondage. You know, when they dragged him into one thing like that, he called his friend and said, "My brother, you didn't explain this thing
to me properly."
Well, Ken Okonkwo
is... It was already too late at that time.
It was already too late.
It was too late. It was in it, deep in it already.
But that was the explosion of Nollywood in Nigeria.
The Nigerian film industry.
Well, all this and more, if you just stay with your looking at your TV tonight and staying with us till midnight,
then
you have this and many more.
Don't go away.
How you doing, man? Is it okay if you could spare that slice for me, please?
Nah, man, I work for the drug. White trash, you got more than me, man.
Really? Hi, how you doing, man?
What's up, man?
Can I please have a slice? I'm very hungry.
I'm sorry, brother, I can't. Not today.
Alright, sorry for asking. Enjoy your slice, man. Hello, excuse me. Can I have a extra slice? I'm hungry.
No. Fuck out of here.
Sorry for asking. What's going on, buddy? How you doing? We ate a lot of, you know, slices. You want the rest? Alright, here you go, man. Alright, take care, buddy. Hello, how you doing? I'm really hungry and it's hard out there, man. You have an extra slice in there? Yeah, you sure? You wouldn't mind? Appreciate it, man. So hard out there. Yeah. Thank you once again. I appreciate it so much. I want to being so generous to me. I want to give you a nice little tip, man. Thank you. God bless you, all right?
Yes, the story is we all need to show a little kindness to each other every now and then.
Whether you have or you don't have.
Yes. All right, let us at this point in time invite Marvin Yobana to join us on set and take a look at the last 4 years of President Jonathan's government with youths.
You're welcome.
Thank you for having
the
me.
The man looks like President Jonathan himself.
Yeah, he's a young man.
Marvin, you're welcome to our show.
Thank you very much.
So nice to, you know, it's always nice getting to see you and talk with you.
Well, what else do we do?
Well, you know, this, we're just talking, Mahmouda and I, we're just talking about the language that is being used by the politicians. A lot of Nigerians are saying the issues are taken backstage and individuals are being discussed. Does it worry you as a young person that the message is not crystal clear and that the politicians, as they will say in our local parlance, are doing us boo boo yaya?
You know, like we say, the village square is somewhere you hear a lot of stories. But what do you deduce from the whole discussion and all the stories you hear at the village square? Wisdom is the key word. You know, the politicians, in quotes, those who don't have anything to offer, they strive on propaganda and blackmail. Those who have things to show, evidence to show, they put it before the people to see, this is what we've done. Judge us on that. That is why people say we are supporting Goodluck Jonathan. Because you see, this is the first time in Nigeria where you have a sitting president put on paper projects that he has done. During his midterm report, it was clear. He submitted a document and asked Nigerians, both opposition, those who support him, and those who are not even interested in government and the private sector, judge me on this. And I didn't hear anybody from the opposition or any of the political parties that are opposed to him say these things were not right or they are not physically on ground. So I thought that in this contest, that what some of our politicians would have done was to put the records before the people and not allow themselves to be dragged into rumor mongering, blackmail,
mudslinging,
and propaganda. Because what the opposition has done is to sell propaganda to the people. But when the facts are put before them, they have nothing to say. That is why you find some politicians say, we don't want to debate, because the people ask you specific questions and want specific answers.
But PDP has also been accused of mudslinging.
I'm not talking about PDP or APC in this contest.
Okay.
I'm talking about politicians
in general.
Okay. Individuals. Okay. Now, Marvin, a few days ago, the president met about 5,000 youths in Lagos. And while talking to the youths, he promised that if he gets reelected, his government will accommodate a lot of youths. He's making that promise now. And a lot of people are saying, look, but you've been in power the last 4 years. Mm-hmm. Why didn't he accommodate the youths in the last four years?
But it's very clear. If you compare Goodluck administration with the past administration, it's very clear in terms of accommodating young people. This is the first government that made a dedicated program for young people.
What program is that?
Yeah, you talk about You Win. You talk about the subsidy reinvestment program. All of this accommodated a lot of young people. Even in the power sector, you know what happened with the training of those who had who were trained to be part of the power sector reforms. These are all young people. Within the first 2 years of this administration, you know how many thousands of people were employed, young people. We just saw on television just the other day how many youth corpus, for the first time in Nigeria, a government recognizing youth corpus to say, look, those who did well to this level, we can absorb them into the civil service without knowing anybody. And let me tell you something. If you look at UN, for instance, as a case study, you find out that this is the first time in Nigeria that you don't need to know somebody who knows somebody for you to get there. People got their business proposals, they did it online, and they were recognized, giving loans and all that, supported, trained. So, you see, let us be realistic about this. It's not like he's giving a promise to Nigerian youths. He has demonstrated it. In 2010, I'll tell you what happened. I organized a program. Was it 2010? Yes. He was vice president then. Yes, 2010. I organized the program. the Nigerian Youth Conference. It was at the Women Development Center. The president, he was the vice president at that time. He came in, he sat down with us for 4 hours. In fact, he came before the program started. We were surprised. They said the vice president is around. He had to sit with us throughout the process of the program. And he was deliberating with us one-on-one, letting us, even where we were making some little mistakes, he was pointing out, look, these are the areas you people should put into your programs and ask government to implement these policies and all that. And he helped us through that line. So this is a man who is endowed to the young people. I'm not saying, if you look at the age difference between him and his contemporaries and those leading opposition leaders, you find out that the difference is very clear. You cannot put, like my father is 84 years today. When I talk to my father, he says, please, Marvin, speak slowly. Why does he say that? It's because the brain cannot grasp everything I say.
Slower.
Yes, and when my son speaks to me, he speaks very fast, faster than I speak. You understand? So you see, this age has something to do with leadership. Because for you to be able to articulate yourself, you need to have a mental state that is stable and very clear. At this stage, Good Luck has gotten a lot of experience. When he came in, people say he didn't have experience and all that. He took his time. And let us face reality. If you look at the economy, for instance, this is the first time in Nigeria that a government sat back and said, look, how do we translate this from an oil economy to something else? Let us look somewhere else. And the economic team led by Okonkwo Wale did a wonderful job, although politicians will be complaining that monies are not coming out, which is the normal thing in Nigeria, sharing money. But the economy worked for the first time. Nollywood, because it was part of the rebasing of the economy, they helped our GDP growth, and we became the largest economy in Africa. How else would you beat that? Now, let us look at housing for workers and what the president did in the civil service, the agricultural sector, the e-wallet. The corruption in fertilizer has been eliminated completely. And just the other day, the pension fund, we found out how many ghost pensioners government was wasting money from. So all these loopholes where money is being cut away, it's been plucked by this administration without making much noise of celebrating somebody, EFCC dragging somebody on the floor and swinging people up and down like we used to know in the dictatorship of some past presidents of this country.
Okay, Marvin, let's bring you back to the topic of today, the youth.
Yeah.
A lot of people are asking, why has the Nigerian youth become so important?
All of a sudden.
And the president, for instance, wherever he goes, he keeps talking to the youth. He said, I want to talk to the youth because you are the future of the country. But we didn't see politicians attach importance. APC, PDP, and the other parties. Everybody is targeting the youth. Why this sudden interest in the youth?
They have the chunk of the voting population. It's very clear. He's a politician. He needs a chunk of the population that votes. These young people are the drivers of everything in Nigeria. Like when I was the vice president of the Nigerian Youth Council, we used to say that youths account for 60% of the population, and that is very true. It has not been disputed up till today. And you know, the electorate are mostly young people. Even the older ones who are part of the electorate, on the day of election, police will be protecting them, they'll be securing their house, watching television. But it's these same young people who get on the streets. They will get to the polling units. They are the ones that make things. They are the engine of this nation. You know what the former Secretary General of the United Nations said, Kofi Annan? He said, the youths are the lifeline of every nation. And any government that severs the youths from its policies and program has severed its lifeline and is destined to bleed to death.
Do you think that the youths realize the weight
they do,
of the responsibility
they have
no, the
on
youths
their
do,
shoulders?
The youths do. I'm an international youth activist. I've been in the World Assembly of Youth, National Youth Council of Nigeria, and several others. I head an ethnic youth group, the Goni Youth Council, and all that. So I understand the power behind our movements. The young people believe and they know that they are the drivers of this whole thing. And that is why now they are becoming more engaged in this process. They are engaging the politicians. And no matter the lies you tell to them, this is a modern technology. You have an iPad on you there. You can just Google. If you give me your name, I Google and I start saying things about you. So the lies are being filtered away from the reality. And I think that this is one president that must be given an opportunity. Why do I say that? It's not because he's from the Niger Delta or that, but he has shown commitment when it comes to empowering young people. It is very clear. Just name one government apart from this government that has actually put up policies and programs that is geared towards empowering young people and small SMEs. You know that Asia today, all the noise Asia is talking about is because they empower young entrepreneurs. And okay, that's what accounts for the growth.
Yeah, Marvin, when the president says to a lot of youths that, look, I'm going to have you all very involved in government if I get reelected, what type of involvement are we expecting? In the next, if the president gets reelected, what kind of government?
Well, from my own perspective, I'll not be able to answer that question directly. But I can say.
Are you people not interacting?
We are asking questions. We do interact.
What do you guys want?
Yeah, because what we want, yes, that will be a better way of answering this question. Okay. What we expect from any government or from the president is, since he's shown commitment and these policies on ground, it would be wrong for us to abruptly say no. Let us try something new. You know, the word transformation is something that is consistent towards growth and moves you better than where you were before. The word change can be positive, can be negative, and it is for a short time, because what is constant always is this change. So why don't we follow a transformational government that has shown commitment towards involving the youth? And what do the youth really want? Nothing much. We want the enabling environment for us to do business, enabling environment for us to be employed, enabling environment for us to be secured. These are all the things we ask for. And an enabling environment for us to go to school and eliminate those corruption that is within the school system that makes it difficult for you to graduate. These are all the little things we ask. And you see, this government, within 4 years, cannot do all this. But they have demonstrated the willpower some other areas, which has now made we as the youth leaders who are proactive trust a government that for the first time, without being forced, without being told, without any strike, they're able to put these things in place. That means if we engage them positively, there's going to be better results.
Okay, you just mentioned about five things that youth wants power supply to do, that will function along your business, education, employment opportunities, security of lives and property, and that kind of thing.
And education.
But what do you want in terms of representation in government?
Well, in terms of representation in government, you see this, I cannot hold the government accountable for the first time, because you see a lot of young people...
No, we're not talking about the past, we're talking about the
present,
the future.
Yeah,
like I said, he told 5,000 youths and promised them that they will be more involved in his government if he wins.
Yeah, but you know that this time, as we speak to you now, let's use Akwa Ibom State for instance. 70% of the political appointees are all young people. That's very clear. Several other states doing the same thing. So you see, the vision is tilting. Now, if you look at the breed of governors we have now, they are more younger than the past. So are we saying that we want to move from these young people to the older generation now? Are we going back? Are we progressing or we are retrogressing? It is very clear that young people are the driving force, and they have what it takes. They have the mental intellect, and they have the capacity and the technological know-how to move this nation to where we want the nation to be.
Okay.
So we need more involvement of young people. And it would be only blind for any Nigerian youth to go and cast his vote for an older man.
I think you have issues.
My father will not contest for the president.
Well, Marvin. Thank you.
Well, it's my pleasure.
Thank you so much.
We would like to
give you this. This is a souvenir.
Yes, just a souvenir.
Is it for the youths?
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. You did a good job.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
And when we return, we talk to two young people who want to share with the rest of us Nigerians what they will be looking for in the new government. Don't go away.
Are you watching Nigeria's biggest late night show?
I think the government is doing its best.
Buhari himself is an issue. Just as the Buhari organization has made Goodluck Jonathan an issue.
We have laws, we have institutions set up to fight corruption.
Advocacy for the chief of health is born out of what they symbolize.
The average Nigerian wants to know, what do you have for him Kanika Yode was with us for a while.
What happened?
I think he came on a journey and discovered that we are too transparent for him.
A banking license was cancelled in one day, an airline license was cancelled in one day.
When I was retrenched, it became worse. Sometimes to even find food to give to the children was hell.
Don't tell us you want a nation that will be the most powerful black nation on the earth. We all want it. How are we going to get it?
O&M Late Show and O&M Sunday Show with Obira Ilo and Mamudia Kuga. Tuesdays, Fridays, 11 p.m. and on Sunday, 2 p.m.
Glad to know you're still with us on the O&M Late Show. And still talking about what do they want, and that's the youths of Nigeria. We have with us in the studio Orire Alao, and the President, National Youth Council of Nigeria, and delegate to the last national conference, Wale Ajani. Gentlemen. Or do we say gentle youths?
Welcome to us. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Well, I'm sure you followed our conversation with Yobana.
Yes.
And we've been asking the question, what do you want? As we go to the elections on the 28th, and then down the line for the people in the National Assembly, the state governors, and all that. What kind of leaders are the youths looking out for? Let me ask you, Wale.
Well, it was very clear. During the 2011 general election, we actually developed a national youth manifesto, which we were able to state clearly our demands from the political office holders. We are also reviewing it for this new election. But one of the key things that we've asked for is a 30% affirmative action for both appointive and elective offices.
So if you take 30,
yes,
and the women take 30.
35.
Yes,
35. No, the women is 35.
35. Yeah. That's 65. Yeah. What's remaining for those of us that are old men?
Well, you can hear from Marvin, and that one is also a clear thing that young people, in fact, we actually reduce it. We would have asked for something like 50%. And from what you asked him, I think the president has done enough. I mean, he will certainly do more, because I was part of the Lagos program. And I know he made a position. He did that in 2011 also, that he's going to accommodate young people, which he did. For the first time, we don't used to have a senior special assistant. Probably they give us PA and SA, and they are not even visible within government. But this time around, it's like, and when you see the way he has been engaging young people, some of the programs, when you see most of the things that he's doing, you'll find out that one young person is part of that
process.
Is that
enough for the youths?
It's not enough. That's what I'm saying. It's not enough. Mm-hmm. He needs to do more. He needs to do more. And we have been saying that, in fact, at a point, I mean, for the first time, we have a minister at the age of 30, I think 31. It has never happened in this country that we have a younger person like that. And we believe that his words, if he's reelected, is going to do as he has promised in this new dispensation. But beyond political office, young people need to run the economy. Young people need to participate in building businesses. And it's a process. So it's not something that can just come like that. And I believe that we are beginning to wake up as young people in this country. In those days, we always sit on the fence. We don't even play partisan politics. But when you see what is going on now, some people that were abusing some of us that, oh, why do you have to support a particular candidate at one point in time? They are now taking sides now, and they are very prominent where they are. So for me, I think we have just seen the future before them, but they are now getting into
the
future.
They are now
things are getting better as far as I'm concerned.
Orire, for you, is it all good no, for no, youths no. with the Jonathan?
No, definitely for me it's not the way my brother, Mr. Wale, is seeing it. Because I believe the youth are really, for long, they are really sleeping. And I believe this is a time for them, for everybody, for Nigerian youth to wake up. Because if we look at the past elections, a lot of things has gone wrong. Even till now, till date, things are still wrong. You look at the immigration job saga and all the rest. Till now, there's a lot of things that we, the youth, don't really understand. The youth are in a way that most of them, they are very gullible. It is what they tell them to hear. Most of them, it is where they are eating from that they will go to and say, okay, this is where I want to belong. Imagine a Nigerian youth, because maybe his father is one big man and is eating from the government, he will like, okay, because my father is eating from the government, I don't need to say anything and I'm eating from this table. So we should understand that that's the area a lot of youth are speaking from. But from a very good perspective, youth should understand that this is a time for change. This is a time for things to move from where we are to where we want it to be. It is not a lot
where
of things.
Where do you want it to be?
Yes. Really? Where we want it to be, it is where a lot of developed nations are. And those things are done by the youth. Those things are not done by the old men. The youth, they came out to vote. That's why we are telling everybody, go out, ensure that you vote. Nobody is going to hold you back when you're going to cast your vote. So those are one of the things that we should look at. We should not just say, because this part is like this. And let's be serious.
You mentioned the immigration job saga.
Yes.
For you, are you not satisfied, at least with the level of job creation? You win. I'm not in government, but there's so many projects that the president says he's put out there, Shopee, opportunities, youths are getting loans to start their own businesses.
I've heard that, and from every angle we've been seeing one or two things. But one thing we should ask ourselves, are those things enough? What are the population of the youths? And if they say, the president is saying, okay, I'm going to carry the youth along, is it now that the president is saying, because he's going for the next term, he's saying, okay, I want to carry the youth along? So we should look at that critically. It's not just for a politician to come and tell us, okay, everybody should vote for me.
No, but he said it in 2011. Do you think that he has not?
He hasn't achieved it. He has not. The president has not achieved it. We are all aware of this thing. He hasn't achieved it. If we look at the large population, the unemployment now, many of them are the youths. So if we have the large unemployed youth, what do you expect? And the president will come and say, I have achieved this, I have achieved that. The UWIN program that a lot of people talk about, who are the beneficiary? How many people have really benefited from it? I work for a private company, and I'm a youth. And I feel the pain when things go wrong. So because the private establishment works with the economy. If anything goes wrong, we are going to feed it. I'm not working for the government. And I'm a Nigerian youth. That is why when a lot of people talk things, I am very agitated. I will just tell them, why are you talking it from this angle? If you're really a youth, if you want change, I'm not benefiting from any government post.
Okay. Violence in elections.
Yeah.
They say maybe the old man plan it in their homes, but the youth execute it.
Yes.
Is there a change of mind now that the youths should be more circumspect and stay away from violence? Or are we just talking about what the old men didn't do for us? How about the ones that the youths are bringing upon themselves, like this violence?
Well, for us to be able to achieve anything, the society, the environment must be peaceful. And if you see the way young people have been taking the process of 2015 election, I think there is no much violence because we have been preaching a violence-free election.
Even in Port Harcourt, River State?
Well, you see, most of those
in
things...
In Kaduna?
When you look at the tempo, it's quite reducing compared to what we used to have in those days.
Okay.
And we cannot get there until we begin to advocate and begin to talk to our people that as young people, you don't need to go and kill yourself. In fact, if any politician is engaging you to go and most of them, they have children who are like our age mates. Let them come
and be at the front. Then we'll follow them. Not we go in and they will now.
Because they'll be in schools in the United States.
You understand? And the major challenge is that even because we are coming from this kind of background, some of us, we even feel like, oh, we want to go and contest election. You just see one young man from nowhere. This one is the son of so-so person. This is the daughter of so-so person. And tickets will be given to such person. But I think we should emulate the position of the leader of this country, which is Mr. President. He has said it clearly that no man's, blood is worth, nobody's worth dying for him, that nobody should go and fight for him. And he has been preaching that. Well, to some extent, it's not very easy because of the unemployment rate, because of the poverty. Somebody who has not seen money in the last few weeks, and these politicians, they will bring money. They are used to it.
But so much temptation.
Yes.
A lot of it.
But as young people, we need to keep telling ourselves that you have a future. And if you decide to go and mortgage your future because of token now, you're just going to die. Those people that have died either in Kaduna or Port Harcourt that you mentioned, I don't know why they have to go to that length. Because they want to.
Alao, what's your take on this? Because we are out of time. Yes. Okay. So what's your take on?
I do tell the youth that you defend your future with your vote and not with violence, because you should be able to kill. If they are giving you token, you should be able to keep temporary player against the permanent gain. And when it comes to the permanent gain, it is all about your future. It is not you defending what they are giving you now, which is a peanut. So you don't need to go out and fight just because, okay, you are supporting this person. Go out there, do the right thing by voting. So I think that is just my own opinion about it.
Okay, gentlemen.
Well, thank you so much. I can present that to Wale while I present this to Alao. So,
thank you.
Yes, for coming
here
on the
I
show.
I was a guest.
Yes.
Good.
So we'll come again.
Yeah. Okay.
Of course,
thank
you're coming.
So thank you very much.
Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you.
All right.
And then the big one, Ken Okonkwo, those that started the craze for Nigerian films. I think that was in 1992.
Way back. They just celebrated 20 years
of Nollywood.
Nollywood.
So, Ken, would you kindly join us now?
With taking Ken on the sofa?
Yes. So we just. We just walk over to the sofa and wait for Ken.
Are you watching Nigeria's biggest late night show?
I think the government is doing its best.
Buhari himself is an issue. Just as the Buhari organization has made Goodluck Jonathan an issue.
We have laws, we have institutions set up to fight corruption.
Advocacy for the chief of health is born out of what they symbolize.
The average Nigerian wants to know, what do you have? For him.
Fanica Yode with what was with us for a while.
What happened?
I think he came on a journey and discovered that we are too transparent for him.
We are glad you're still out there. It's still your O&M Late Show. And joining us now is Kenneth Okonkwo.
The man
that they didn't quite tell everything.
I've been living in bondage.
Ken, you're welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
How has it been?
Oh, I'm blessed.
You know, when I started seeing you on TV talking politics, discussing the economy, I said, he took leave from Nollywood.
And then I started seeing you again.
And we put a call to you, the O&M team put a call to you. And you say, I'm so sorry, I'm shooting a film in Lagos.
Oh, yes.
Are you not getting tired?
No. And the reason is very simple. I took onto movie as my passion, as a hobby. You know, before we entered into it, there was no industry.
Yes.
You know, so it was just like playing football or playing table tennis or swimming. It was a hobby. All through my life, I've been trained as a conservative executive. I was trained in business administration, University of Nigeria. I was trained in law, University of Lagos. I was trained in theology, and I was trained in diplomacy on my master's level. And so, but, you know, my passion is with movie acting, and I knew it from the war. And so immediately I finished my university degree, I moved into the acting world. And fortunately, our entrance into the movie world was as if it was destiny calling on me, mm-hmm. and it heralded the birth of Nollywood. And then after that, because of the success of that movie, Living in Bondage, you discover that it was now competing with my profession. And so what I thought was going to be a hobby
now became
the profession.
The profession.
And the things that we are supposed to be professions now appeared as if they were hobbies.
So, so you were like in a dilemma.
Yeah, but you know, movie is a spirit. Like I said, you can never drop your hobbies. You cannot drop your hobbies because you are going to them because you have passion for them. And you did not anticipate it was going to be the source of your livelihood. And so, from time to time, I still go back to school. I'm a perpetual student. I'm offering my PhD at the National Open University of Nigeria. And so each time I take a leave to go back to school, people will think that I'm leaving. No. In movie, there's no retirement age.
Yeah, because there are roles for very old people as well.
No, sure. No.
But how does it feel,
Ken,
you know, to be synonymous with Nigerian Nollywood? I mean, you were, the lead man, so to speak, the leading man from day one. When they mention Nollywood today, they say Living in Bondage, and then they mention Kenneth Okonkwo. I mean, you're synonymous with the industry itself. How does it make you feel?
Great. You know, I feel I'm a child that is so beloved by God. You cannot ask for a better blessing that in a country that has up to 180 million persons, talented, great people, God singled you out to give birth to an industry that has grown so much that it's been recognized internationally, nationally, and this industry is home made in Nigeria. I've always told people that what excites me most about that Bondage was that it was shot in an African language, shot in Africa, telling an African story. And so that's why the people abroad have never claimed it. They just know that Nollywood is made in Nigeria. And you see, every other youth took a cue from there. You know, so our musicians having the boldness and courage to be indigenous. When they make their raps, you see them making it indigenous because they have now seen that the people will always identify with the people, with the things around them.
Ken,
you know, so
Ken, would you say that
I feel just blessed and
this
privileged.
Originality that excites you?
Yes.
That is still with Nollywood. Has Nollywood lost some of its originality?
Yeah.
Some it's indigenousness or
indigenousity. Now, I want to
some
tell you something.
Nigerianness
or Africanness.
My answer is that it has not.
Oh, really?
Yes. We're still telling our stories. Watch all the stories. But I want you to accept the fact that whenever anything comes out and is successful, it attracts the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's natural. And so the entrance of people with different intentions will always manifest in their products. But the essence of Nollywood, which is to reflect our society, is still here. You may talk about equality, you may talk about watery stories, you may talk about lack of originality by some people, but the essence of it that we are now telling our stories is still there.
Okay. Let's talk about Ken the politician.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, we're seeing, set of people from Nollywood venturing into politics. So we read some time ago that you were trying to pick up political office in your state, in Enugu State, to come to Abuja, House of representatives, I'm sure. Yes. How did that go?
Well, you are absolutely correct. Like I keep telling people, the source of my greatness has never lied in any patronage from the government. It has never lied from anything outside the love of the people. I was the first person that interpreted a movie that was accepted nationwide. What a love. And for 20-something years, I've been able, by the grace of God, to sustain the love of these people. And you see, what can you do for them, for this love? Privately, I have empowered the youths a lot. There is a football cup in my community that is contested every year. The widows are there. So I thought privately with my resources, I could help the people. But I discovered that each time I plow back my little resources, it's as if the problem is increasing.
It's never enough.
You know, and I now said I need a greater platform, a better opportunity for me now to help these people that have made me strong. Now, that was my attraction to politics. And because I am a new entrant, I just registered my name. I needed to learn the ropes. And when I saw certain things that was below my irreducible minimum as standard, I decided to boycott this initial one in order to make sure that my name will be, you know, synonymous with standards, which God has helped me to start with,
like
living in bondage.
Like he fights and runs away,
well,
lives to fight another day.
Well, it's not a case of running away because I'm still in politics.
Okay.
I'm still campaigning with my party.
I think he's saying something like, yeah, they use the word initial one. So initial. I think you're already looking at 2019.
You know, actually, I feel that my boycotting the primary, I did not sustain any political injury to North. I just opened a bright political future to nurture because I am Kenneth Okonkwo and I cannot fail. So, but the issue here is that you must learn how to strategize, because success is won not by political tantrums, but strategy and wisdom. You must learn when to move, when to retreat, when to re-strategize, when to attack. So these are all political ropes that you must learn. But I am telling you, I enjoy the fact that I am in politics, because that's the only place you would have the opportunity to impact to the society that has been very good to you. And so it's not a case of running away. No. No retreat, no surrender.
No surrender.
Yes, so, I'm moving on.
So let's finally ask. You have become a symbol.
Yeah.
You have become an icon. What do you, besides what you try to do with politics,
yeah,
what do you want to leave behind?
A legacy of establishing a standard, being a model that younger ones will be proud to follow. Now, I tell you something. Living in bondage was something that came as a blessing from God. I contributed nothing to it.
You contributed your talent.
Talent is a gift. I never went to any school of theater arts.
Okay.
I just told you where I was educated in. People say they like the way I walk. That's a gift. I've been walking like this since I was born. My face, my gesticulation, and I came with them. Gift of God. Now, if God can privilege you to have such qualities which he gave to you that are admirable by people, it will be very, very unfortunate if you do not maintain that standard. I tell you one experience I had. I was driving in Lagos.
Very quickly.
Right. In Lagos, people drive very crazily. I was very crazy. So I drove and stopped the guy that was driving crazily. He looked out. He saw me. He couldn't believe it. Now he came out of his car and was smiling. He knocked at my own car. And he said, no, Nandim Bano. He met Aria.
What does that mean in English?
Is it when we are getting mad or going crazy, you will now join us.
You, Andy.
You, Andy. So he was not claiming that he was right. But this was his model. He couldn't understand that if he is wrong, he should be looking up to this man to learn how to be right. How can this man now come?
Join him.
And join him.
So you just know that you
have become a role model in the society.
That other people are looking forward to, you know, learn from.
All right. Final question before we go. Recently, Nollywood celebrated 20 years. As it's the practice internationally, you know, when a movie is so iconic, after a while, it is re-released. Are we ever going to see the re-release of Living in Bondage? So that, I mean, younger people who were born, I mean, imagine a child who was born.
Another interpretation.
A child who was born when that movie was made, probably about 20 years now.
Yeah.
So it's already an adult.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know that with time, it's going to be remade. I've seen scripts that looked like them. And I said, no, you don't get it for me to do it. Give it to other people.
Okay.
So you discover that Living in Bondage is rubbing off in a lot of movies, if you watch the movies, telling it in different ways. But I wouldn't want to be the person that would now go to do the Bondage.
And leave it, I mean, you did the original.
Absolutely.
So someone else.
But even that original, will it be re-released? For people to, you know, maybe see it again all over.
Better quality.
Sure. You know, it's now, you know, in CD. It's now in, these are all, you know,
formats.
Is that correct?
Thank Andy, you. So nice to have you here. Little token from us to, I mean, I was a guest on the O&M show.
Oh, yeah. I appreciate this. You know, you
for your coffee.
Doing a great job here.
Thank you, Ken.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Andy.
when he mentioned Andy, my heart skipped. You know, I thought Merit had appeared again. Thank you very much.
Okay. All
right. Just have a seat.
Yeah, well, that's our package for today. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, why don't we do it again?
Friday night at 11 p.m.
Don't forget you can watch us on www.8blnews.com. I'm Obiora Ilo from Abuja, Nigeria.
And I am Mamude Akure. Thank you so much for watching and good night.